Welcome everyone to our edition, this year's edition of the Dean's Global Forum. As you know, the Dean's Global Forum is typically a once a year event. It's a signature event at NUQ where we invite people who are making a difference in the world from academia, from business, and from the media. This has been a great week at NUQ. At least for me, I hope you share my impression. We've had a great town hall with faculty. We had a great film screening of one of our faculty yesterday. Today we had our students exhibit their final projects, and the week is just about to get much better. So because of our guests today. So I will read a little bit to introduce our distinguished speaker, and then we will have a conversation for about 40 minutes. After which we hope to get questions. If there are, I can see some students in the room, we really hope to get questions from students as well. All right? So our guest today really does not need an introduction today, but I will do it anyway. It's a pleasure to welcome Dr. Amal Mohammed Al Malki, who's the founding dean of the College of Humanities and Social Sciences at HBKU. Dean Amal is not only a leader in Qatari and Arab higher education, but also a distinguished scholar. She's written a landmark book about Arab women and Arab news. Her PhD is in comparative literature, but she has built institutions throughout her career dedicated to not only cross-cultural understanding, but literal understanding, right? And I have here in mind the Institute for Translation. Translation has been a theme at NUQ this week. Professor Kaskas's film yesterday was a translator, and in some ways the whole plot hinges on one word that should or should not have been said, depending where you stand. So it's truly a pleasure to welcome Dean Amal with us today. She has a long list of accomplishments that, in the interest of you hearing directly from her, I will not discuss further today, and I'll move straight into the conversation, right? So, Dean Al Malki, one of the first thing we like to know about is our speaker's professional intellectual trajectory, right? So we begin with a quick question. What led you to this life? What led you to want to get an advanced degree, be an author, and be a teacher, and then a leader?
Dean Marwan, first of all, thank you so much for having me here today. It's a pleasure. It's a true pleasure to be here today, and I'm very humbled. And yes, I do see some students, but please, if you can grab more. I'd love to see more abayas in the room. Please, just go and call them. Tell them I need them to be here. Because I think they can draw some examples from my life. What led me to academia? Very interesting. I think through my work, I've been working on Arab women, as you all know. And getting out of this body of literature that speaks about Arab women, whether it's from East or West, thematic recurrences. And I'm a writer. I've been a writer since I was 15 years old. So I'll go by themes as well. What led me to academia was quest for identity. So my personal quest for identity is what led me into academia. When I graduated from Qatar University with a degree, a bachelor degree in education and English and education, was very tough for me back then, tough for a generation of Qatari women who wanted to do the you know, who were different for a reason or another. My reasons were that I'm a hybrid. My father is Qatari, my mom is not. I was exposed to, I was very cultured, you know, we traveled a lot, we were taught to be bilingual from early in our lives. So I really wanted to go and get the experience of living in the UK, London in specific, because I know London is a melting pot. So that was first. Second, when I chose to do a master's in translation, applied linguistics, Arabic-English translation, it just fit perfectly. I thought it is, you know, a natural second step for me as a bilingual. Little did I know that it would open up different theories and different angles into my identity back then. And I wanted to do the things that were not been done back then. So I wanted the challenge to study abroad and such, you know, I did. I did my master's. I was exposed to theories of language identity, cultural identity, language and power, representation and belonging, which hit me so hard back then. When I was done with the master's, I was still not satisfied. And I'm here with an intention to reveal stuff that I haven't talked about, but I really wanted to be a journalist. So I did apply for a PhD. Exactly. So I applied for a PhD in journalism in the University of London, and I was turned down because I needed a bachelor degree in journalism and a master's degree in journalism to be able to continue my education. So it took me some time to realize that, okay, let me go to SOAS, back to SOAS, and apply to the Near and Middle Eastern Studies Department, which I did. It started with the proposal on images of Arab women in American media, which I didn't continue, by the way, that back then, because, you know, it was the middle ground between what I wanted to be as a journalist, but also the issues of representation and identity. Then I was introduced to the world of post-colonialism, and this is when it hit me very, very, very hard. I needed to go through that. The theory, the spin-offs, whether third world feminism or Islamic feminism, to understand that there is a framework that I could find myself in. I'm not a misfit, not because I was different and I felt that I questioned my own identity as a Qatari, as a female, but also as a representative of this small and conservative culture that you know, I did not fit. It was only through post-colonial theory that grounded me. So the whole quest for identity and identity crises that I went through came to a self-realization by the end. I was very happy that the next phase of my life would be grounding knowledge into action. And I was very lucky. You know, there were a couple of the hurdles at the beginning when I came back to Qatar with a PhD in 2003 and applied to Qatar Foundation. There was only Cornell and VCU. So Carnegie Mellon was just starting, and when I applied to them, they said, it's unheard of, we cannot hire a Qatari faculty. So that was a huge challenge for me. Yes, there was a doubt, so they doubted my ability to enter and compete on a national level. In academia, in American academia, and although doubt is a negative emotion, but, you know, speaking about women and imposter syndrome and all other things, I managed to turn that doubt into an empowering tool. So I took the challenge, and the challenge was to go to CMU in Pittsburgh and get certified by them and you know, teach there for some time. If I managed to convince them, then I would be back as a visiting assistant professor, which happened in 2005. So that was the beginning of my actual career. And I don't regret it. I actually love it. That period of my life proved to me more than others that I can make it. I made long-lasting relationships. The former head of the English department at Carnegie Mellon is still my mentor. And people got to know me. So got to vouch for me somehow. So she didn't get it easy. It wasn't because she's Qatari and we have a campus in Qatar. On the contrary, she got it very, very hard. When at the same time I saw them advancing and investing in their own graduates at CMU, and this happens in all branch campuses, right? You invest in your mother campus graduates and researchers and get them to Doha as a beginning of their career, but this wasn't offered to me that easily. So that was the first huge step in my academic career. The second one, and I stayed in Carnegie Mellon for 11 years, got promoted by them, got tenured, and after that, The second huge step for me was when I was recruited by Her Highness. She realized my work in translation because I was co-organizing an international translation conference, an education city. I had started writing my book. The book had started taking some attention. So this kind of highlighted my work in education city, and she recruited me, and she said, I want you to establish a center in education city that would be a mediator between everything we do in academia and American branch campuses, but also how to transfer that knowledge into Arabic, how to localize all of those efforts into efforts that would be meaningful and relative and relevant to the local context. This was huge. It was a dream come true for me. The third big step was when I was appointed as a dean in 2016 to establish a college that didn't exist. So TII happened. Alhamdulillah, was very successful. Besides the academic programs and portion of TII, we do promote multiculturalism and multilingualism. We teach 12 languages. We have changed how the industry perceives translation, especially good translation in the country. So there is a need now for local translators, whether in communication or, you know, other areas. But being appointed as a dean was a huge step as well, because there was no college whatsoever. And here is when your personal conviction intertwines with your professional career. As you may know, I'm a feminist. I'm a big believer of women's rights, and I'm an advocate of women's rights. So I established a college that has a strong commitment and managed to recruit people with strong commitment to social justice. So all of our programs that we designed are geared towards social justice. All of the research that we do geared towards social justice as well. And I'm very happy and proud to have the only women's studies program in Qatar, and a very unique one in the region as a whole.
Thank you. So speaking of social justice, feminism, women's rights, your research has focused a lot on basically the intersection of gender, specifically women, and news and media. Now, you published your book more than 10 years ago. A lot has happened since then, whether in the Arab media industry and news here, whether the way women journalists have been treated in a variety of contexts, whether it's war reporting or on social media. From your perspective, from the findings of the book, how do you assess the changes that women journalists in particular, but in general, working women working in the media, in the public eye, have experienced in the last 10 years or so?
So yes, the book was published in 2012, but believe it or not, until this day I get invitations to talk about the book, because it managed to do, to achieve things that other studies about Arab and Muslim women, and by the way, everyone conflate between both, not all Arabs are Muslims and not all Muslims are Arabs, and I wanted to look at Arab women from a very wide lens, regardless of those, you know, differences. But it managed to capture the booming of online media through news that was translated into Arabic by an Arab. So there was that angle of producing authentic and indigenous knowledge about this part of the world. That which was very important and which actually fed into the programs I created. Yeah, I've got Middle Eastern Studies program in the college. Why? What's different? What's different between this Middle Eastern Studies program and others? I would say the lens, right? And we are producing knowledge rather than recycling. And I don't know, if you agree with me or not, but I think that what we have been doing for so long is recycling knowledge about Arabs, Muslims, and especially Muslim women, okay, from a very angled lenses. This is our opportunity to create something new here. So this is what I think I managed to do in the book and through my career in academia. Let me tell you a bit about the book's findings, and I'll definitely answer your question. Some of the book's findings were very interesting. Of course, it captured. We looked at women and whether they were depicted as passive or active, comparing it to a whole body of literature from the West, right? That looked at this very narrow angle. We discovered that Arab women are invisible, especially in hard news, which is a global, of course, phenomenon. So they were neither active nor passive. They were basically not there. Secondly, we discovered that pan-Arab news were depicting women more than local press. So we focused on pan-Arab news press, Al-Hayat, Al-Qabas, and others. So we found that women are actually represented in multiplicity of roles. And this is where we came into that thematic focuses in the book. It's a huge book. But the second part of the book is the closest to my heart. So the first part was the American way of doing it, right? Qualitative and all, quantitative and all that. But I really wanted to look at the quantitative because it exposed the experiences, the realities, the lived realities of women. So some of the themes that emerged were anger and resistance, war and conflict, empowerment, education, and all those themes. One other finding was, and this is pre-digital era, right, was the dichotomy between invisibility of women in Arab media with this emerging, what did I call it in the book? Emerging phenomenon of women's media, okay, but that unfortunately only catered for women's ability to buy. Purchasing ability focused on the cosmetic rather than women's active participation in politics and other things. So there was that issue. What happened post the book, after the book was published, was the so-called Arab Spring in 2011. We captured a little bit of it in the introduction. So we spoke about Nawal. Yemeni woman, Egyptian woman, without specifying names, but we didn't capture that digital activism, right? Which was very hybrid at the beginning, and you're the expert here, but what we've noticed during the so-called Arab Spring was a huge movement towards cyber feminism or digital feminism, in which women participated and stood beside men, whether in Tahrir Square and other platforms, that took a hybrid format. So they started cultivating interest, collecting their supporters, spreading their messages via internet. Okay, but then they physically were there in Tahrir Square and other venues. This also, we saw also that with Saudi women. So in 2011, for example, Manal Sharif started a campaign to drive, right? She started that also through a hybrid format. Let's do that, then they did it. Then the hybrid format took a purely online format. The second campaign that women did in Saudi Arabia, which was 2016. And that was for the guardianship campaign, right? Now, guardianship is another topic, maybe we'll talk about it later. But that took a purely online format. So the digital feminism or digital activism is a topic of many studies. what happened after that for women is they were given a platform to enter the public sphere, especially we're talking about activism, which is very male dominated. We're talking about a public sphere that is that has been very, not just far away from women, but very unfriendly. We saw that, we saw them doing it, we saw them succeeding, whether academics, activists, and for example, I'm an academic with slash activist as well, whether journalists and whether politicians, women politicians, have really embraced that form and utilized it and used it for their own causes. And we saw a rise in human rights conversations and dialogues and issues online too. But what happened afterwards was reality hits. The injustices, the lack of freedom, the gender-based violence targeted towards women in our society replicated online. Again, I say our societies in specific because this is my area, but this is, again, a global phenomenon. Of course, we speak about the shadow pandemic right now that took both physical and an online form. But is the digital sphere still safe for us? Really, it depends. It is still a tool.
If you allow me a quick follow-up question, right? So we know that the online environment, particularly social media, can be ferocious, can be a very abusive environment but it's more abusive for some groups than others, clearly, right? And the abuse in almost every single instance is gendered. So somehow women are exposed to people who identify as women, are exposed to more vitriol, more abuse, online, particularly when they have their own opinions and they're vocal about them. Now, this is a global phenomenon. Do you see any ways in which it differs, the manifestation of these of online abuse, trolling, vicious attacks? Do you feel it differs in the case of the Arab world? I mean, we've had at least a couple of Al Jazeera journalists who were subjected to vicious campaign, right? No male counterparts were subjected to campaigns like this. So could you, this is also part of translation, right? So how would you assess, are there differences in your evaluation between how this type of abuse works here and elsewhere? And maybe you want to share some of your experience with this, if you feel like it.
Sure. Misogyny and sexism worldwide. there's no difference between East and West. Wherever you are, it exists. It manifested itself online. I think there was an Amnesty report in 2017, if I'm not mistaken, who spoke about this in specific, and it looked at women across nations. What differs really, because again, online is mirrors really, legal systems and social norms in our societies. And this is where we have a problem. The legal framework in our societies do not protect women. Whether it's cybersecurity, if they don't protect women in our societies, how can we even think about cybersecurity and what and how it actually incorporates, the legal system, you know, the legal issues that are the legal statements that would protect women. So yes, I would say we're hit harder in our part of the world because of the entrenched discriminatory social norms that we have that really bypass and really transcend national and state laws. And this is why we see the same experience here being mirrored in North Africa, for example. And it's really interesting because, yes, you spoke about the Al Jazeera journalists. And I have also gone through several hate campaigns for my opinion and for my advocacy. Is there a legal system that would protect me? I'm not sure. I'm really, really not sure where we stand in terms of protection. Now, it's very interesting because if you look at all of our institutions in the Arab world, there is the language, right, in there that would put us or pose us as equal in terms of citizens. In terms of citizenship framework, men and women are equal. Shouldn't men and women be protected equally as well? This is another case. I think there should be we need to scrutinize, and we need a place. But we need the research and the studies that would contribute into raising awareness. But doing something on research base that cannot be translated into policy papers or policy change.
But how do you do this, right? So on the one hand, whether in Qatar or elsewhere, we have anti-defamation laws, we have anti-label laws, particularly online, the cyber law and all that. But this is an issue that, some people say goes back to the French Revolution, right? That you have laws like this are defined in universal terms. Mm. They protect the individual without a recognition that some individuals are subjected, because of the way the system works, to more abuse than others. Mm. What would it take, you think, to, for example, whether in Qatar or the wider Arab world or anywhere else, right? We have some countries, evidently, who have done more work on this than others. What would it take, for example, to embed the recognition that women tend to suffer much more abuse online in understandings of what cybersecurity is? Right, cybersecurity all over the world is understood mostly in two ways. One is the kind of this almost national security umbrella, which tends to be geopolitical, military, and then there's corporate security, right? Trade secrets. You're both an academic and you're an activist. You have your constituency in Qatar. You have your audience. What can be done to inject these notions that human security? Sometimes based on gender and sexuality, sometimes on other categories, should be part of these discussions of what cybersecurity is. What can be done? What should we be doing?
Inject women into the discourse. So let me tell you something. It's really interesting. I'll go back to saying when I was faced by the hate campaign, the first thing I did is call a couple of my friends, female politicians. One is a German politician and the other is a Kuwaiti politician. And I'm not a politician, but they are vilifying me in a context that is very similar to the context that they use against women politicians. Basically, our experiences are very, very similar. Why is that? But the German politician has a law that would protect her. What we need in our Arab world is gender sensitive revision of our laws. When, again, our laws are very, very masculine. They have been created by male. When we speak about the citizen, we usually think about a male citizen, not a female citizen. When a female citizen comes and asks for a right that a male citizen enjoys, she goes to another room and have another conversation. So how do we review and revise all of our laws from a gender perspective? Harassment. We have a harassment law in Qatar, but we don't have a sexual harassment law in Qatar. So laws are very important. Secondly, language we use. We don't have enough studies that would criminalize the language of sexism. When I attended one of the classes at the college in digital humanities, and this beautiful young woman was looking at sexism in some 18th century novels, right? Okay, through parsing the novels, the context. So there is the language that can, she detected the language of sexism in English. We don't have it in Arabic. It's so complicated in Arabic because besides the individual words that could be used, you can use actually a hadith against a woman within a context, right? or it could be a religious statement or sentence, whether from al-hadith al-Quran, could be taken out of context and also used against women. Okay, and if you look at the whole context, it is sexist somehow. So the language is a barrier as well. The third thing is, I would say, because we don't have grassroots women associations and women groups that would stand together. We don't have a critical mass, and I think this is a problem with Qatar in specific. It's much better elsewhere. But when I was actually attacked on social media, and this was very recent, it started with after my interview, and this was the first interview I do in Arabic, and the second interview in 10 years. The first one was in Al Jazeera English when my book came out, and the second one was in France 24. I was in Arabic, and it apparently hit them so hard, hit the conservative pockets in this society and across the region very hard, that a woman would come out who has a position, who has followers, as they assumed, would say, I'm a feminist, I'm with gender equality, you know, women are just like men. They couldn't take it. But I couldn't find solidarity from the inside. I found solidarity from the outside. Of course, international solidarity, but also regional solidarity from Lebanon, Jordan, you know, feminist groups called me, how do you want us to help you? I didn't want their help. It just meant a lot for them to call and say, we stand beside you. In Qatar, of course, I got lots of love messages, but they were private messages. Those are the women who are afraid of coming out and saying it out loud. Why? Because we don't have grassroots women organizations and women groups.
So, you know, I remember you and I talked during that campaign, and the kind of sting that causes. It sort of paralyzes you, right? When everything you do suddenly is under a microscope and not a very friendly microscope. But I think you said something that I think is very important, which brings us full circle in the conversation, which is about women, gender representation in general, and language, right? So here's my question to you. You said a couple of things. First of all, that somehow doing an interview in Arabic hit a chord that usually it doesn't. And that's my experience as well, right? If you're in the region, if you're speaking in English or Spanish or French, you can basically say whatever you want. Once it's in Arabic, the language that the assumption is the public sphere follows, then it's different, right? But you also mentioned something else, which is taking excerpts from the Quran or the Hadith or any religious political text that matters, right? Every culture, every religion, every polity has its master narratives and its master texts. To me, the question is the sort of the reverse. What do people like you, do people like us, need to do to take important local texts and translate them and interpret them in ways that serve social justice? Right? I mean, you and I talk a lot about how different it is to publish in English versus Arabic, how different it is to even give a talk at a university in English versus Arabic. You get completely different reactions. You will get backlash in both cases, but from different communities on different issues, right? So what is the work that needs to be done? Should we be doing that kind of work to make sure that whatever arguments for social justice, for gender and sexual equality, cannot be refuted on the basis of being imported or imposed from the West, but can be seen as legitimate works of local minds, local action towards local goal to change local realities, right? And not to shape societies into the image of other societies. What is the kind of work that needs to be done? Can it be done? Should it be done?
Well, the good thing is there are people like you and me who are actually thinking about that and finding ways of consolidating the academic narrative with the popular narrative. And there are officials. I have met recently, last summer basically, with an official who said, you know, we do value your academic narrative on gender equality. We see the rift that this is, and sometimes tornadoes that this is causing in the society. And we want to make sure that we bring those two narratives together. And I agreed on one condition, that I'm not going to water it down. So I've been told, why don't you say I'm a social justice activist and say instead of saying I'm a feminist? Because each time you say I'm a feminist, you're actually hitting them hard. I'm not going to change that language. You can't change, when you change the language, you change your conviction. What you could do is work on, again, authentic and indigenous narrative that would take into account the human rights language and bridge it with the religious traditions, right?
So you think religious traditions and culture and norms are a must, like it's an eye of the needle. You have to thread your argument through that for it to resonate.
It locally has to be included. It definitely has to be included within our context. It has to be included for so many reasons. Religion is a part of the politics of the nation. Okay, identity politics in our nations have religion as a core component. Yes, some states use it in a way, and other states use it in a different way, but it is a huge component. So yes, and I think there should be a narrative that bridges the gap. Instead of me, I'm a big advocate of Islamic feminism, for example, but I'm not an Islamic feminist. I can't base my feminism on Islamic feminism. Okay, I think I'm more of a hybrid feminist. I look at the human rights rhetoric, and again, because we're in a culture that where the religious authority is taken away from women. Women cannot get involved in the religious context. What Islamic feminism did was they actually broke that taboo. They actually reinterpreted Quran from a feminist perspective, right? Do you know that Islamic feminism, for example, was a course that I taught in Carnegie Mellon in 2010-11 and haven't been taught since then? So is it taking currency in our world? It's not even being popular in our region. So yes, I think there should be a conversation. The way I believe that our identity was constructed, going from cultural hegemony of English over Arabic and the post-colonial perspective of decolonizing your identity through decolonizing the language into multiculturalism and the cultural hybridity that we believe in right now, being bilingual and having a conversation between those two big languages that constitute who we are. I also believe that there should be a dialogue between the human rights rhetoric and, yes, the religious and the cultural tradition in our world. Maybe just by digging deep into historical books, into the golden age of Islam, and why did women prosper then but unable to do it now?
So it's a matter of, I mean, if you look at the great texts of the three big monotheistic religions that sprung from the Middle East, right? Mm-hmm. Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. There is sort of a face value argument that a lot of what these great religions preach is geared towards social justice.
Yes.
It is geared towards recognition of human beings as being in the image of God, and right? And so there's a lot of work of interpretation and explanation, revisiting some of the texts, but also revisiting some, again, I mean, to me, the big issue that I face whenever, and I think I've spoken to some of my colleagues here about this, right? Which is somehow we have to find ways to make the different worlds that are involved in this reconcilable and visible and audible and understandable to each other, right? And so we go back to the metaphor of translation, right? We go back to issues of language, and how you parse language, how you make language resonant, how you make words that may be 1,000 years old and concepts resonant to people today, resonant to young people particularly. I mean, we're educators, right? So we have to think of how what we teach and what we discuss may influence the generations that are emerging to, again, have these conversations.
But the language is a language. It's combination of letters, if you think about it. It's what we make out of this letter. My daughter, who's 11 years old, came yesterday and asked me about a word, and I'm like, and she's asking me, why is this word a bad word? And I'm like, the word as it stands is not a bad word. It's the way we use it, right? Yeah. So if we look at the text, all of the sacred texts that way too, how did every generation, how did they use those words to empower, to better their lives, rather? Because there is also a justification of fanatics who go back to those three sacred, you know, religions and say, but no, you know, but we do have examples of, you know, otherwise, right? So it's really what you make out of it. And this is where human agency has to come in. I'm done with people saying, but this is how it was done 1,500 years ago.
There's always a tension between, right, established tradition and newer interpretation, right? And newer desires, new aspirations for change. And I think, again, as educators, we're always at the forefront of this, yes, right? I mean, in many ways, a lot of these questions are negotiated when minds are being shaped and people are learning new things. And it's not just the students who learn, right? We learn a lot from them. I think, if you don't mind, it's time to open it up to the community. I think we may have, hopefully, a lot of questions. I want to flag again that if there are students in the audience, both from me and from the speaker, we really want you to be involved. So maybe I can prod maybe the first question, if there are students in the audience, to raise their hands, and then we can move to the rest of us. Go ahead.
Many of my female friends might be aware of the things you mentioned today, or might have read up on things that you mentioned today. But a lot of my male friends wouldn't have the slightest clue of what you were talking about. So do we agree or do we disagree on the fact that it is probably important to have that male, it's probably important to have that male sector, or the guys, or whatever you might call them, integrated into this curriculum as well, like encourage them to be taking these courses? Because I feel like even though one side may progress with that knowledge, unfortunately we're just at a paradox where we have, you know, it's like a 50-50. So you have one side here, one side there, and there's really like, I feel like the other side also owes it to, you know, the women that they know, or yeah, the women that are generally there in their lives, to be aware of all these things. And I feel like then there can be actual progress and like a movement. What do you think?
Definitely. Men are our allies. Gender equality should be mainstreamed across, okay? And a part of this mainstreaming is being opened up to men and women equally, definitely. For example, our masters in women's studies, you assume that it's all women. We have men taking the masters. No, we do, and they are activists. I have a lovely male student who will go back to Indonesia, and he's working in an NGOs and fighting child marriage, and he has girls, so it's personal to him too. So definitely, men and women, nothing is gonna change unless, and to be very realistic, men in our societies are the one who make the laws. Right? So there's, yeah, whatever we're doing here won't be translated into policies or change, sustainable change, unless you men stand beside us, definitely.
I think it's also, if I may, it's also very important to not to essentialize, your whatever your gender is with your sort of political position,
exactly,
right?
Exactly.
It's I think it's very important to think of equality as something that affects everybody,
yeah,
in different ways. Mm. And gender studies, for example, now is under attack in the in the unlikeliest of places, yeah. In Europe, in North America, on you know, where Islam is not an issue, yeah. Right? So power has a weird way of working itself through all kinds of narratives that matter, whether it's representation or religion or tradition, mm-hmm. Right? Yeah.
Yep.
Please.
Yes, please.
Thank you for the lovely talk. And for me, one of the things that you said resonated with me so much when you said that I'm not going to back down on calling myself a feminist. And I do come from Pakistan, and those words, feminism, intersectional feminism, calling yourself a feminist, were seen as very progressive and only seen in communities that received a higher education. But one of the biggest struggles I got when I openly started to share a lot of feminist ideas and started calling myself a feminist was the backlash that I received from older women themselves. Mm. A lot of the criticism, me and my mother had a lot of backlash. We had different viewpoints about what feminism was. But what I saw was that both me and her were on the same page. We wanted the same things. It's just that the fear of being called a feminist was there. So in this fight of gaining equality, and I do believe that, I think in gender equality, you can never have 100% of it, and that should never be the goal of it. But the first step, I do believe, is uniting women on the same page, at least. So when you yourself call yourself a feminist very adamantly, and when you meet a woman who is not able to take that, how do you tell her that you and her are both on the same page?
Through discussions. Let me tell you about this generation conflict. And this happens all across, by the way, and even within my family. I had a recent interview, and this is a funny story. So my mom thinks that the attack on me was because of the fact that I wasn't covered in the interview. Now, I'm not covered now, am I? People know that I'm not covered. So she believes that. She believes that maybe, right, if you put your head cover, people won't mark you out, won't see you as the other, and will start listening. She has a point. I know for sure that she has a point. And this is how she negotiated her own identity within this society. It doesn't mean that she's weak. On the contrary, she's much stronger than me. She had 5 kids. You know, 4 of them are women, all of them highly educated, married, not Qatar. You know, we are because of who she is, right? It's us taking that, okay, and modifying it, making it ours, right? And ours now is not just the issue of naming, but we need to assign the right terminology to it. We are a part of the international world treaties, right? As long as we try to disconnect from the world and say we're a very special case, we won't get anywhere. So I believe in that balance. I believe in negotiating on daily basis, which we do. But I also believe that we need to be connected to the global consciousness of social justice, the global movements of women and gender equality. And we need to find that balance. And I think it's our generation and then your generation that would be able to do that. So now I'm struggling with namings, right? Because again, representation, identity, right? You know, the tendency to reduce people into one type. What we're asking actually is breaking that type into many different types. Yes, I would, and this comes to the second part of your question, I respect every single woman making her own decision, whether covering up, not covering, whatever ideology she has. I have met with women who run, several women, Qatari women, who run for Al Shura Council, okay, and to understand their agendas. Some of them were very conservative, okay, things that I do not subscribe to. But this didn't mean that I didn't support them. I did. Because this is what we need, critical mass of women, different women, like we have a critical mass of men, diverse men.
Please.
Learning, but we're also kind of doing this unlearning as well, where we're kind of dismantling things that have already been assumed or maybe not thought about. You talked very interestingly about this kind of awakening you had in your postgraduate education when you were introduced to post-colonialism. So I'm wondering, how much do you think there might need to be some kind of structural overhaul of education from a much earlier level, you know, primary schools, secondary schools, where the kind of norms are being taught to kind of get to a point where people have discussions about these social justice issues earlier, or they are part of a conversation before it gets to here and to the masters and so on.
Very important. It's imperative to have this embedded in the curriculum as early as nursery, if not. One of the things that I'm really interested in working in, and I will start working on very soon, is how to embed gender equality across the curriculum in Qatar Foundation to begin with. Now, this is a conversation that is easy to have within our context here. It could be harder to have outside here. So again, what kind of narrative, what kind of justification, what kind of argument should this be embedded? And this is where we say, localize your justification, show them, you know, the value of having this embedded social justice, gender equality embedded from the cultural perspective, because again, you know, when we speak about Islam, there is a long history of Islamic tradition that started translation, that started, you know, enlightenment a long time ago. So why don't we tap into that instead of tapping into very recent examples that take us nowhere? Again, how do we mitigate and how do we create this discourse? And it's easy. It's not easy, but I believe that Qatar Foundation and our faculty, lovely faculty here, as you said, you came here and you unlearned. I went to Pittsburgh and I learned many things that I didn't learn. I was a post-colonialist going to Pittsburgh and I learned a lot of things. So those kind of encounters brought us together. And I have to tell you, when I started with CMU, many of my conversations with my colleagues were, no, you're not here to rescue me. No, I'm not forced to wear abaya. No, I'm not forced to marry my cousin. It's like, seriously? So there, we had those discussions, but it was, 18 years ago? I hope that those discussions don't exist anymore. So we've come a long way. I think now the next step is, how do we consolidate and bring all of this knowledge together to create a new culture for all of us?
Thank you. Khalid? And then we...
comes first in terms of the representation and the form. So even if I want to maximize my impact, I am more than happy to compromise on the language. So that what matters at the end of the day for me, kind of the...
Many, many academics like you actually told me that. Yes, compromise on the language.
Yeah. Now, was written by a Dutch anthropologist in Oxford. 1930s, and it wasn't about women in the country. It was, he traveled the region for 20 years, and then he was an anthropologist writing about everything. When he wrote about the role of Arab Gulf women in the region, it was amazing, kind of shocking. So these women used to run the houses, the neighborhoods, because men would go fishing in the sea for 2-3 months, sometimes 4 months.
6 months,
then
actually.
Then you have the women, they were very empowered, local. This is indigenous culture, where you have the women who are very powerful. In fact, they have been disempowered by oil and money and all of that, because of the segregation, and then they need, they can stay at home without the need for any work. If you start from this point, from this example, about Gulf women, that your grandmother, it is not kind of far in the history, no, it's in 1930s, 1940s. Your grandmother used to be maybe a female head of majlis, and they used to have them. Majlis, the majlises that we know in the Gulf, some of these, they were headed by female figures, which is beyond our imagination nowadays. So you have this great, rich example. Yes, I would adhere to this. I would start with this, instead of going to Western feminism or whatever, with all due respect, of course. And this doesn't mean to have this kind of disconnection totally. But you start from there, and then you can build on whatever kind of discourse and import and modify, justify. But that is the argument. That is the thesis.
No, definitely, and I don't reduce that at all, and I appreciate it, and I'm very proud of this history, in specific local history. But my work and my activism is grounded in third world feminism, not Western feminism. But this does not mean that I don't see commonalities between all forms of feminisms, really.
Thank you. So, Susan, last question. We're coming close to 1 o'clock when some people have to go and teach and meetings. So, please.
Thank you for really helpful talk. I was wondering what advice you would give to a white feminist working with women here. To one of the themes I've heard strongly from you is finding voice. How can we, being the other, facilitate and help that process?
Okay, let's start with, you're not here to help, you're here to understand. The choice of wording plays a huge role, of course. And I've noticed that any conversation starts with, what do you need from me? How can I help you? Is a turn off, right? Yes. Yeah, no, this is serious, and I wouldn't do that if I am within here, because still I'm an academic and, you know, came from, studied abroad, so kind of some people do consider me as the other. So I wouldn't start with how can I help you. I would teach, raise awareness, and show them the possibilities. I think this is the most empowering thing that we could do as educators. And what I hear from my students after they graduate from especially women's studies is, this was a life-changing experience. Thank you so much. All we did is teach them. Okay, all we did is teach them. But at the same time, we offered them all of those possibilities and opportunities, internship here, work with this NGO, right? But without pushing them towards a certain path. It's just the matter of showing them that the possibility, because again, you know, some women, not all, okay, have very narrow, narrow lives and narrow perspectives and conservative life. So the moment you show them that those are possibilities that you could do from the place you are, by writing, by advocating, by even being you, because every graduate goes to somewhere and work. And right now we're embedding them in everywhere, HR, communication. It's lovely to receive an email or a phone call from someone saying, wow, your graduate, they educated us, educated all of us that we needed to have a gender perspective towards this campaign, and this campaign does not really serve women in specific. Those kind of conversation never had before. So start with that equal footing where let's understand each other, tell me what you want to learn, and I can offer you that. I hope this helps.
Thank you. I think ending on this notion of showing the possibilities, I hope today we sort of showed what a candid conversation, what possibilities it can open. I hope you come back and visit us soon. You don't need an official invitation to be with us.
Maybe come and teach here.
To be part of these conversations. Thank you.